Joining me now on the Milan Records podcast, I'm so ecstatic to be talking to Lesley Barber today because the score for Manchester by the Sea has completely blown me away. And I'm going to tell you why it's blown me away, dear listener. And that's because it's an orchestral score. It's not a synth score, which is something I completely forgot even existed because of the amount of synth scores there are in the world today. So Lesley, how are you?
I'm great. It's really lovely to be speaking with you, Tony.
Excellent. And that is true, what I've said. I mean, I grew up in a time, in a place where orchestral scores were the thing. Jerry Goldsmith, Bernard Herrmann, you know, the usual suspects.
Yeah, it was lovely to work with Kenny because Kenny Lonergan, we've worked together before, as you know, and he loves classical music, has a deep knowledge of it. And we like bringing live instruments and live, you know, bringing the orchestra to his scores. And so it was, yeah.
I mean, on this, on Manchester, you composed, conducted, produced, and played piano. So you've done it all on this score.
I mean, it was interesting. The piano solos were sort of demos. They were sort of sketches, but then we liked the way they were working with pictures, so we left in my first take performances. So that was interesting, and then I orchestrated around them. But
So were they kind of used as in the kind of the same way that a temp track would be used?
Well, with Kenny, Kenny usually sends me sent me the script. And then I hadn't seen anything that had been shot yet, and I started working on the themes then, especially the vocal themes, the vocal recordings. And I actually did I sort of demoed or did recordings of the initial vocal themes, and they just worked. And when Kenny was editing, he could use this music, and then by just sending him sketches and him emailing or phoning me and us having a lovely shorthand and dialogue, we were able to establish some themes early and then develop them as he edited the film and finished it.
Having worked previously, that has to have, you know, been a huge asset, kind of knowing how each other works and the language, like you mentioned, you developed this shorthand kind of a thing. I mean, that's the kind of thing that's invaluable, or I would imagine, to a composer when you're working from a script as opposed to from the image on the screen.
Well, yeah, especially, you know, you have that kind of collaborative relationship, you trust yourself to just work from a really intuitive place and feel free to record something and just have an idea in your gut that something's going to work, record it, and wow, it works. And I mean, also you have the luxury of time. So many films, when I get hired, there's 5 or 6 weeks to actually come up with the themes, orchestrate them, program, do all the programming, and deliver the finished score. So if a filmmaker who brings you in with the script, it's just so lovely because you can kind of think of some ideas that might be a little riskier and try them.
Did you kind of amass a wealth of music?
Well, I just started playing the piano a lot. And then I also had this idea when I was reading the script that Lee is the character played by Casey Affleck, the lead character, is in this place where he's being asked to start over again in a way, in this sort of post-traumatic state. And I had this idea of it being set in the East Coast, where this wave of immigration came in the 1600s. Like, it's one of the oldest, you know, places where this wave of immigration started, and that there was maybe some very old music from the very first sort of music that came over in the 1600s to this very same place where life was sort of starting over again for so many of those people. And they were post-traumatic to some extent. And so I started kind of looking at some of the hymns and some of the music of that time. And I found that to be a fairly big influence in the score, especially on the vocal pieces.
Hmm. Do you listen to other composers when you're actually composing yourself?
Well, I tend to not listen to contemporary scores. There are some scores that are in the back of my mind that I'll be thinking, oh, I want this to be sort of like the feeling I got when I watched, when I heard Preisner's, you know, Three Colors Blue, or I want the feeling of Merry Christmas, you know, Mr. Lawrence. Or in this case, I had this feeling, this, like, I love what Kubrick does. I love Barry Lyndon, the way the music is used in a sort of sculptural, deliberate way. And it's also, again, that, you know, Kubrick uses borrowed pieces and score in some of his films, and a sort of Scorsese, you know. So I'll kind of think I want it to be this kind of statement, but I very rarely listen to completely contemporary scores, because I feel like a lot, I mean, many of them seem to come from the same place, as you were saying. And it's, I really want to always feel like it's a place of real newness, you know, when I'm in the score. But I listen to tons of music. I listen to a ton of hip hop and R&B. Like, actually, I was listening a lot to the score from Shaft while I was doing this, which is completely different, but I'm always listening to music completely different from what I'm doing. So I was listening to Superfly, and I was listening to Isaac Hayes, and I don't know, whenever I was taking a break.
That's fantastic. I mean, I read kind of in doing some research before speaking to you, I read online some of the people that are cited as being influences for you. And I saw John Carigliano, he did a fantastic score for Altered States. That's one of those film scores that if you've ever heard it once, you need never hear it again, because it will never leave your consciousness, because it's fantastic. And I mean, you also... I read that you're a fan of Steve Reich, and it's weird, because I spoke to the composer Rob Simonson last week, and he also cited Reich as being kind of this influence, and it's a name that I hear more and more popping up these days with composers. Is, you know, kind of his work, because it was not necessarily film music, but kind of in that minimalist classical way, is that something that you would try and emulate? Not necessarily on this score, but just in your body of work.
I mean, I do write music that has patterns to it. And I was doing that before I heard Philip Glass's music and Steve Reich's music. And then when I, you know, then I became aware of the music, like when I was, you know, much, much, much younger, and realized, oh, I can feel comfortable writing this kind of music, you know, which I would have anyway. But, and I do like the way... Glass and Reich's music works with picture. I think it can be extremely effective. So when those themes come to mind, like one of the title tracks for this film, when it comes naturally to me and it works with picture, I just go with it. But I think there's something really, you know, it's really, there's a beauty to minimalism in that it really recharges diatonic music and in a new way. You know, that's always really thrilling when you can take, you know, the same eight notes and various harmonic progressions and somehow make them seem completely new again.
Thank you. I was listening to Manchester by the Sea, it was, as I said earlier, it was so refreshing and just kind of uplifting. And from what I get from the film, the film hasn't actually been released yet, so I haven't been able to see it, but from what I get from the film, the score is kind of, it's very melodic and it's very uplifting in places, but there's also a seriousness to it as well. And I don't mean seriousness in kind of in a dour way. I mean, there was, you know, it kind of, the score made me sit up and pay attention.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, Kenny also curated some of his favorite music, into the score. He loves to use borrowed music like Handel is used a lot in this score with my music, and it's a nice fit. And there is a sense in the music of fate, and the music sort of exists outside the characters in the way that fate sort of exists outside of us to some extent, and just sort of grabs us by the pants and does with us what it wishes. But the music, in a way, had that sort of omniscient presence, and we wanted it to be like that. Kenny and I talked about it being sort of big and slightly dark, but a kind of warm darkness. And we talked a lot about where the music comes from emotionally, you know, or just in terms of what is the new voice that the music is going to bring to the film. So there's nothing about the music that is redundantly narrative. I might not be saying that properly. It's not just narrative reinforcement. It's a different presence in the film.
No, I mean, I must confess I didn't know much about the film before Milan reached out to me and said, would you speak to Lesley? And I said, of course I would. And then I've listened to the score over and over, and I just thought, oh my God, I fall in love with this more and more every time. So now I want to see it married up with the images. So have you seen the finished product yet?
Yeah, I've seen it twice. I saw it. It was amazing. We had a really quick rush at the end of the process to do some more music. So I, like, between the 7th and the 12th of January, I did an orchestral session and wrote another 10 minutes of music or something, and recorded it, and then got on a plane, and the film premiered a week later at Sundance. And it was really exciting to see it then. And then after Sundance, Kenny did some adjustments to the film, and we did some adjustments to the score as well. And I saw it then again just at TIFF last week, and it was amazing to sit with the audience at TIFF and take in the film. It was just, it was one of the best screening experiences I've experienced.
Wow. See, now I want to see even more, but I have to wait until sometime in November before I can even see it. You mentioned that the film was slightly altered from its first screening to its second. Has that happened to you in the past before, where kind of everything has been in place and the film has been screened, but some slight changes were made, or you've had to go back and then change some musical cues?
Well, there's a couple of things. Like when I did Mansfield Park, we recorded the score, and then the film was really in a great place. And then Harvey Weinstein was executive producing it, and he talked to the director, Patricia Roseman, and said, you know, is there a wish list of what you would do if I said, you know, you could go back, and I hope I'm saying this right, and, you know, do a couple of other shots. And in that film, there was some helicopter shots that were added of like the English landscape that enhanced the story. And for those, you know, I went back in and just deepened the orchestration in that, so you could really feel the landscape. So really like a much bigger orchestra during those cues, so you could really just feel the money spent. I don't know. It was super fun to reorchestrate for a big orchestra in those situations. The Sundance films, quite often we do go back a little bit, because quite often you don't know if your film is going to be in Sundance till about December 5th. And then that I I have a funny feeling it triggers financing or something, because then there's a big rush on the score, and you know, quite often I'm finding that I'm scoring things very quickly between December 5th and January 5th. And then, you know, the film lands on its feet for the screening. And then if it's, if it gets picked up for distribution, sometimes you do have the opportunity to go back in, and sometimes edits are requested, picture edits, and the music has to be adjusted. So sometimes there is a little bit of adjustment, particularly around the Sundance films, but it's really fun because you get to see it in, you get to reach the finish line and feel really good about it. And then sometimes you get to go back and just change a few things. So it's I love it. Absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, there are always things that we might want to tinker with or change just a little in our careers. So, I mean, that's fantastic to have the opportunity to do that. Do you personally have a preference to the type of score that you enjoy doing? I mean, is there a genre or a director that you've yet to work with that, you know, you think, I really want to take a stab at that?
Well, quite often I get asked to do sort of hybrid scores that are, you know, programming and orchestration, because I love working with the orchestra and writing for orchestra. At the same time, I would love to do something that's a little more Blade Runner-y, like sort of more of the programming side of things, which I adore, and that includes really lush orchestration, but has that sort of 80s vibe to it. There's a lushness and emotional quality to some of the scores that, you know, these days quite often you're asked to do a lot of drones and to sort of hide out in the background. And I like those big statement scores. And it's fun to work with a director who lets you do that. Like even in this score, that Kenny embraced this idea of the a cappella, you know, vocals. You know, a lot of directors that, you know, they're not confident enough to sort of let you have those bigger ideas. You know, to bring in that kind of profile to the music. So I kind of would love to do something that's either not animated, but maybe like futuristic or apocalyptic, more guns. I don't know. I can sort of write some kind of really lush orchestral and electronic music, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, you referenced Blade Runner. I think
James Bond. You know, like
yeah. I mean, that would. I'd love to hear that. I mean, Blade Runner is kind of one of those. I don't want to say landmark or key. It's very much the only score that I think every composer that I've ever spoke to has all mentioned. I would love to hear you do something along those lines. That would be fantastic. Whoever's listening to this, please, please let this happen. So if we can, though, Lesley, I'd like to go back a little bit and find out some about your musical background, really. So when When did you first kind of become aware of film music?
Films like, I mean, when you're a kid, like, you know, the theme from Goldfinger, I just thought that was crazy good and listened to it a million times and realized, wow, this was actually written for this film. And that's why I love it so much. It's just so inside the film. And, you know, there were other films like Chariots of Fire and, you know, I'm dating myself now, but that I realized that, wow, the score is part of this. The first record I bought, like the first vinyl I bought was the score to Godfather, which I listened to a million times. And I really loved also Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence was an early score that I bought the cassette of and played it about 1,000 times. So I got into the way some of these scores just brought this profound uniqueness to the film and this haunting quality where you're remembering the film, you're remembering the music well after you've seen it. And it just stays with you, whatever state that film puts you in.
So were you kind of buying film music or listening to film music alongside contemporary music and there was no kind of differentiation for you?
Completely. You know, if Trainspotting came out, I would get the Trainspotting. I was like, I have a ton of soundtracks and but mostly interesting ones, like not so much like ones that have a really, you know, fantastic quality to them that are beautifully written and work well on CD, because not every score does. And it's really fun when you can work with a filmmaker who wants your music to sound, for lack of a better term, you know, like a needle drop. Like if it is on the CD, that it's going to be a really great standalone piece of music. So, you know, some of the scores tend to have that, like The Prisoner and, you know, Superfly and Aliens and Requiem for a Dream. Clint's music is great for that. Carter Burwell's Fargo. You know, these are beautifully produced, gorgeous albums. Mark Isham, some of his scores are just gorgeous. So those were early influences. Those guys are, you know, a little older than me, and I used to, you know, grab their scores.
You graduated from the University of Toronto with a master's degree in music composition. What did you want to do with music? Did you any aspirations to kind of be in a band or go on tour or anything like that?
I like my gear, and I like writing music and playing it. It's really selfish for me. And the performance aspect is not as interesting to me. What I love about it is collaboration and actually the scripts and the filmmaking and the idea of bringing this new part to filmmaking or storytelling. So when I was doing my master's degree, I was supporting myself by being a composer, working in the theater community. So I did about 20 scores for everything from radio drama to, you know, plays to dance pieces, interdisciplinary work. And slow, you know, some of those people were making films and started asking me to score films. And when I started scoring films, I absolutely adored it. And so even though I kind of started off thinking that I would be an orchestral composer, I was always frustrated by the limitations of just the instruments in the orchestra. I always wanted to bring something different in, you know, and I love the visual formats of film. So when I found film, I really thought I found my place.
Hmm. So Manchester by the Sea, the film, there's a lot of buzz around the film already. I've been reading some message boards and some articles on the internet. The film is getting kind of rave reviews from everybody that's seen the film. If you could sum up the film, what is Manchester by the Sea to you?
Manchester by the Sea for me is a film about when things happen to people and you can't get over it. And it's completely, well, how do you live your life when there are things you really can't get over. And when fate just gives you a hand that is just insurmountable, doesn't matter how many sort of retreats you go on, it's just not going to get better in a way. How you keep moving, and Kenny's just written an absolutely beautiful portrayal of someone who is getting on with their life after something truly tragic has happened.
Well, fantastic. I shall wait wait for the film to be released. But Lesley, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to join me today. It's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you.
Thanks, Tony. It's been a pleasure to talk to you too.
Excellent. The score for Manchester by the Sea is available from Milan Records on November 18th.